And action. On May 11th, 2016 at 3:35 a.m., our worst fear as parents was realized. After nearly 30 hours of fighting, our beautiful, kind, hilarious, amazing son passed away due to medical complications following a seizure on May 9th. Jackson was born on June 11th, 1998 in Boise. He's the first of our two kids. Jackson was an incredibly happy and cute baby, and it was actually a common thing that complete strangers would ask to hold him. Barb would never let him, and I would almost never let them, but sometimes I caved if they looked trustworthy.
So, just wanted to share some things about our son Jackson. So, Jackson was a very happy baby, which made it great for us as parents. As soon as though he could walk and get into things, he was full of joy, but he was full of mischief. And then one thing I want to share with you, at an early age, he actually still had a fascination with sunglasses, as you can see in this picture. He was actually really quite the ham. In this picture when we got him, his power wheel, that was a surprise. He was so excited, his grin was just totally contagious. But one of the things, like mischief stuff that he would do, is we'd be turned our back for a minute, and I remember being in the kitchen, and he would crawl his way into the pantry, and we had stored paper towels in the bottom of the pantry, and he would kind of shut the door, and when we found him, he had unraveled like three full things of paper towels. And he thought that was the funniest thing ever. He had this huge grin on his face, and you couldn't be mad at him because he would kill you with that grin. He was just the funniest kid. He liked to climb into other things, like when the dishwasher was open, he'd think you'd try to climb into that, our entertainment center, so then he could look inside the speaker box. He just was that kind of fun kid when he was little. So I think one kind of special thing I wanted to share about my son is we had this bond. So I had wrote this song for him since he was a baby, and I'm not gonna sing it to you because Jackson would be so embarrassed, and so would I because I can't sing. But it talks about, like, he was named after his dad because of the middle name Elliot, and he was named after his great-grandpa Jackson. And he was also born on the same day as my great-great-grandma, who's Budley, who was very dear to me. But I would sing it for him every night, you know, after we'd read books, to the point where he was probably 12 years old, and I would sing him this song. And then I remember his dad gave him a bad time, saying, "When are you going to be 16-year-old and you have your girlfriend and your mom's going to come in and sing you your song?" And he kind of laughed about that. And I think shortly after that, I quit singing him a song. But whenever he was sick or he wasn't feeling good, and I would kind of lay with him, and I'd still sing him a song. And I think he appreciated that. And one thing about the song that is pretty amazing, at the end of it, it said, you know, "You're the miracle in our lives." And I'd say, I think you know how we feel about you. And then I would say that, like, God loves you, Jesus loves you, and mom and dad love you. And then I'd say everybody loves you. And I think that's why I really wanted to share that, because it's been amazing to see just the outpouring of love for our son Jackson and how he's touched people with his kindness and his sense of humor. And he was just an amazing kid. I miss him every day of my life.
As Jackson was midway through his terrible twos, which really for him were kind of hilarious and fun, he became a proud big brother to his sister Amanda. He was absolutely enamored with her, at first, anyway. Then, after a few years, he really started to enjoy her again. Actually, Jackson was always a great big brother. He would love to play games with his sister when they were together. He mentored her, especially at video games, and he protected her when people were mean to her. The kids were fortunate enough to have some wonderful nannies while growing up. Lindsay and Christiana spent many summer days taking Jackson and Amanda, and usually their friends, to Roaring Springs. Jackson loved his sister. He would spend hours comforting her whenever she needed it. But his affection wasn't only driven out of necessity. Jackson would also just hang out with his sister just because.
My brother is every wonderful word I can think of, because truly I know that he is a good person. The relationship we shared was lovely, although when we were younger we fought about the most ridiculous of things, from who rode in the passenger seat to who would use the towel with a tiger on it. It's silly thinking back on it now, but I realize that I just simply wanted to be like him. Jackson was always a smart guy, and he knew how to improve any situation.
Even when my brother and I were younger, he always knew how to make any situation better. I remember there was this one time when me and him had both got in trouble, and who knows why, but my parents ended up putting our favorite toys on top of the refrigerator, and we were just miserable. We sat looking at those toys at the very top of the fridge, just bawling for hours because all we wanted was the toys back. And we just both sat there crying, and finally Jackson, what he does is he climbs on top of the stove and does this strategic move to grab his toy, and he ended up grabbing mine too, which, you know, made things a lot better.
He was always there for me when I needed him. On many occasions, my brother has tried to protect and help me through hard times. When I had messed up, Jackson would hug me tight and make me believe that everything would be okay. He genuinely helped me by saying everything I needed to hear. He also would continuously mess with me, because like my mom, I am very gullible.
I remember this one time my brother had tried to trick me, and he was successful, but we were out in our front yard, and in our front yard we have these bushes that put these leaves on them, and these leaves have this layer to them that you can peel off, and I remember we were doing that, and he had told me that if I kept rubbing the leaf that it would eventually change to all of the colors in the rainbow, and being the like little 6-year-old I was, I believed him. And I remember I spent hours and, well, just a very long time rubbing leaves and thinking that eventually they would change to a bunch of colors. And eventually Jackson left and got bored, and I remember I came back to him like, Jackson, what do you mean? They didn't change colors whatsoever. And he just started laughing his head off because he knew he got me, and it took me a while to realize what he just did, but yeah, Jackson was always a prankster.
Jackson was interesting, and what I mean is that he wasn't afraid to make a fool out of himself, which I very much admired. Jackson did a lot of things that were very goofy.
Even the other day, my brother was trying to mess with me again. So what happened was he started placing these toys from McDonald's that were these like emoji plush like toys and stuffed animal kind of things. And he started putting them in the truck that I had been driving, which is my brother's truck. And I didn't notice it for a while. And then one day I just remember I was driving and all of a sudden I saw this very noticeable emoji thing on my rearview mirror. And I remember being so confused and wondering like, who on earth did this? And so I went around asking everyone, and everyone's like, no, I think you're just crazy, man. You probably forgot that you did it. And so I just was so confused. And it turns out I asked my brother about it, and he just started laughing. And I was like, oh, okay, so you did this. And it turns out he had wanted to keep putting more and more of these stuffed animal toy things in the truck until I noticed. And yeah.
And there are many times that my brother and I did the strangest of things that make me laugh today. I can honestly say that my brother will never be forgotten. From the times that we would sit and play video games for probably too long of times, to the times we'd get food together and in the carway, he'd always blast the music too loud, to the moments we'd be exploring and I'd follow him wherever, and to the times when he always had my back.
Jackson attended Cecil B. Andrus Elementary, Heritage Middle School, Renaissance High School his freshman year, and then from his sophomore year on, he went to Rocky Mountain High School, where he was on track to graduate this coming June with the Rocky Mountain High School class of 2016.
Alright, so one thing I wanted to share with you is recently I was blessed with having a couple of just amazing days with Jackson. One thing is, we used to go on... Hold on. Let's cut. Alright, so one other special things I had with my son is, you know, we would still go on mom and son dates. Not very often, but we still did. Because we're the only two in the house that really love seafood. So we'd go have seafood, and then the last time he took me to the Star Wars movie, and I just remember how great of a night it was. We were just talking about him and his plans for college and for the summer, and then we of course had to analyze the whole Star Wars film, and we had all those great moments. And the one thing that I'm very fortunate, it was Mother's Day shortly after we lost Jackson. And I just had this wonderful day with both of the kids. They both got me just these great gifts and just showed, you know, their love and emotion. Jackson had got me all these clever gifts, but he got this pug mug for me. And I adore it. For those that don't know or have been in the house, we have a 14 and a half year old pug named Fred who is been a wonderful dog, but he's at that point in life where he can't hardly see, he can't hardly hear, he has extremely rotten breath, and he's very annoying. We love him, but he's so annoying. Okay, so here's Fred. Poor guy. He's having some problems breathing. Hey, buddy. Ugh, it's bad breath. But anyway, the joke is I love him. And Chris tells him when he won't stop barking or whining for food to walk to the light. And then a lot of times I look at my cup and I look at Fred and I'm starting to like my cup more than Fred, which is kind of sad. But I mean, he has been a great dog, but poor guy. Anyway.
Jackson was an adventurous kid. He enjoyed exploring, whether that was on family vacations, in the wilderness, or even within his own backyard. He was an avid and exceptional gamer, and it didn't matter if it was video games or board games. He just loved to play, and he loved to win, and often he'd love to dominate. So a lot of you guys know Jackson by his gamer tag, SpongeWatch, but what a lot of you guys might not know is that really, that's not Jackson's gamer tag, that's mine. Well, it's Jackson's, but he earned it. So Jackson really started his video game adventure probably at the age of about 2 years old. He used to sit on my lap while I would play Flight Simulator and other games like that on the PC. And he was just enamored with it. And of course I would give him an unplugged controller and he'd think he was playing and he had a great time. But later on, I ended up getting an original Xbox console and you know, like a super awesome parent. By the time Jackson was about probably 3-4 years old, we were playing Halo together. Again, him with an unplugged controller and me actually playing the game. But it wasn't long after that, maybe, might have been 5 years old, 6 years old, he was actually playing. And he was actually really good at it. And pretty soon, we were, you know, playing together, and it really, within a month or two, he was actually better than me. And I, you know, I kind of just maybe gradually got less interested, because when your six-year-old son is beating you repeatedly playing video games, it's kind of embarrassing. But he was always really good about it. So by the time he was older, you know, I don't know, maybe about the time we got the original Xbox 360, of course, you know, he was playing a lot of video games, and we were signed up to Xbox Live, and I had the gamertag Sponge Squatch, and Jackson played all the time with all of his buddies under that. But the reality is, it's kind of like the analogy I make is, if you go into a bar and somebody's playing pool, and you beat the champion, then you own the pool table. Well, Jackson was the champion at the Xbox, and I can never beat him, so he owned the Sponge Squatch, and he's owned it ever since he was probably 8 years old. And so, yeah, I tease that it's my gamer tag, and even all the way up until I moved to Singapore, I told him I was taking it with me, but he reminded me that it really belonged to him, he'd earned it, so I had to get a new one. By the time I moved to Singapore, I changed mine, so. He loved riding his dirt bike. He was crazy about having airsoft battles. But really, he was just genuinely happy anytime he got to hang out and be goofy with his friends. Jackson was a kind-hearted young guy. Certainly not free of poor judgment. He was a teenage boy after all. He always was sincere though in trying to make things right whenever he messed up. What we know about Jackson and what so many people have expressed is that he was always smiling and always lifting people's spirits up. He loved people, especially his friends. He didn't hate anything except for CenturyLink. He hated CenturyLink, absolutely hated CenturyLink. He was always upset, especially at about 8 or 9 at night when CenturyLink would start getting horribly slow. And he hated it because the lag in the game would be so bad that sometimes it would kick him out of the game altogether. Or sometimes he'd have somebody right in the sights of his gun and they'd end up killing him instead. So yeah, not a lot of love for CenturyLink, so I apologize if there's anybody from CenturyLink listening to this. More than anything though, the last 2 years of Jackson's life, he loved to spend all the time he could with his beautiful girlfriend, Kinsey.
This month would have been officially 2 years and 3 months that Jackson and I were together. And I think that's a pretty long time for kids our age, and we did do a lot of growing up during those couple years. From the beginning, Jackson was very kind and thoughtful while still being funny as ever. So the first time Jackson and I hung out, he didn't really know what to do. We kind of drove around in the car for a little bit, and he was like trying to show off a little bit in the Hummer. But then we came back to his house and we watched a Disney movie, Tangled. I don't remember which one of us chose that, but he ended up holding my hand through it, and he was really sweet and cute. And another story. The first time we went on a trip together, we went to McCall with his family, and he was really excited to take me lots of places. And I remember we walked down from where we were camping and we found a tree to carve our initials into, and that was really fun. Jackson made sure there was never a dull moment in our relationship, and he always made me and others around him laugh. So one time we were over here and there was a party going on for his family friend's little boy. It was his first birthday. We were inside and we went into the garage to get drinks out of the fridge out there, and there's all this Jell-O in there, and it looked like really nice, good looking Jell-O. So he's like, oh, do you want some Jell-O? And I said no, but he took like a huge slab of it and just ate it all in like one bite. And then a few minutes later, he realized that they were Jell-O shots,
and that they were pretty strong, so we had to sit and just, he just had to like wait for the effects to go away. So in the 2 years of Jackson and I dated, we never had a class together during high school, but I would always hear from my friends about how the things he would say during class, and I knew that he always wanted to be the person in the room that everyone knew. He was the funny guy. So even though he was so lighthearted and comical, he always had a very serious and emotional side he may have been shy about to others, but not with me. He always made his feelings very clear and had so much love and passion. Our first anniversary, our 1 year anniversary, was in February of 2015, and I knew that he had planned out like a little date for us, but that's all I knew. He was surprising me. And so when I got home from school that day and I walked into my room was filled with red heart-shaped balloons, and at the bottom of each balloon was a picture of us, and on the back he had written a note. And then later that night he came and got me, and he took me to one of his family's favorite restaurants downtown. Our first Valentine's Day was before we were actually like officially dating. We were only 15. And I wasn't really sure what to expect because we weren't dating yet, but when I came over on Valentine's Day, he had gotten me a pretty big bouquet of red roses and candy and like a big stuffed monkey, and ever since then he's always gotten me red roses because he knows that I love them. And for our 2 year anniversary was only a couple months ago, and just this past February, and he was kind of stressed out because he knew that he'd kind of gone all out for our 1 year, but this year he couldn't drive, so he kept like stressing to me that he was worried that I was gonna be disappointed, and I kept telling him, no, like anything you do is gonna be perfect. So he surprised me, and we went to Eppie's, which is another one of his family's favorite restaurants, which I've grown to love too. And so Jackson loved to surprise me and bring me, well, just give me nice things and just make sure I knew how much he loved me. So this past October, he went on a trip with his dad to Kauai, and he brought me back this ring, and it is it's actually sea glass, and it's my favorite color, and this is one of my favorite things he's ever gave to me. I think it's so pretty, and I think I'll probably wear it for the rest of my life.
Okay, so I wanted to share just another story about Jackson. So in the fall, we had his senior pictures done. And I remember I was telling him, hey, you know, go ahead and bring props for the senior pictures. And Jackson was like, what am I gonna bring for props? It's like, what am I supposed to bring? So the joke was that he'd do this awkward senior picture with him like lying on the ground with his Xbox and all of his controllers and his games. But of course we didn't do that, and so I told him, like, well, you should bring your truck. He loves his 1972 Chevy truck, and I'm like, and also we should, you know, bring your beautiful girlfriend Kenzie, because it'd be nice to have, you know, pictures of you guys together that we had professional. And so we went and did his pictures in Eagle, and I just remember, like, initially Jackson was surprised me. He was actually a lot more photogenic than I thought he would be, and despite him being not really that interested in doing them, he did an amazing job, and the photographer was great. But I remember when they were doing this picture together, and Kinsey had this cute little smirk, and the photographer, Rachel, asked Jackson, I want you to do that same little smirk that Kinsey had, and he looked down at her, and they just nailed that cute little smirk picture together, which was one of my favorites. But I just remembered when we started taking the pictures of them in the truck, and it was sunset, and them sitting in the back of the truck bed and just looking at him, this young love, this really true love, and you could just, everyone there could feel it. And it just hit me, I'm like, these actually felt like engagement pictures to me. And I just had this, it just brought me back to when Chris and I were first together, because we were the same age, and we had that, young love, true love, and it was just really a beautiful moment. I wanted to share that.
There are so many things that we loved about Jackson, but the one that keeps coming up is his awesome and eccentric sense of style. We always joked that he dressed like a super hip old man, kind of a blend between a coffee shop broista, a Nordic woodsman, a comic nerd, and a retired accountant. Whenever you're missing Jackson, or even just for the heck of it, we encourage everyone to find their inner Jackson in celebration of his life and just wear it weird. While we still struggle to try and understand why something like this could happen to our son, and we still cry every day, we've also been able to reflect on his life and smile and laugh. I wanted to tell a story about something that a lot of people have asked me since I've been home and since Jackson's passed away. Most people know that I've been living in Singapore since January for work, and it was really hard to be away from the family. I mean, just because it was hard to be away from the family. But my first week there, Jackson had his first seizure, and of course I was terrified. I hadn't even moved into my house yet. I think it was my first or second night there, and I was still staying in the hotel getting ready to move in, and my immediate instinct of course was to come home. But the doctors actually said that, hey, he's healthy, everything's okay, and you know, this isn't an uncommon thing, so let's kind of wait it out a little bit. So long story short, there he got on medication and everything seemed like it was okay. And so since that point, I've been living, I'm gonna need to do a partial retake on that. So let me go ahead and, he should be able to cut it back in. So Jackson had a second seizure, and when he had the second seizure, I did come home, and because I needed to make sure he was gonna be okay. I couldn't just stay over. So I flew home and on an open-ended ticket and came to see my family. And Jackson went through a bunch of tests and everything really looked normal. Everything was normal with all of his brain scans and everything. And you know, the doctors and neurologists explained that these things do happen, and that there was really, they had him on a medication and seemed to be getting him regulated. They really expected that at some point in his life he would grow out of these seizures. So after some convincing, I went ahead and went back to Singapore. And it was tough and scary at first, but you know, as the weeks went by, I became more and more confident that he was doing okay and he had been feeling okay. Last week though, when the call came in, for whatever reason, it really wasn't an abnormal time that Barb or happened to be Darren's cell phone that was coming through. It wasn't an abnormal time that they would call me, but I don't know why, I really felt like something was wrong, and I answered it right away. And they let me know that, you know, there was a problem with Jackson. And so I was able to pull myself together and with the help of friends at work, get home and eventually get on a flight. And I'm telling you, the flight was the hardest part because you're out of communication and not knowing what's going on. And by the time I'd gotten on the flight, I knew it was very serious. And in fact, I was told that it was almost certainly going to be fatal. And so I'd been in communication with Barb from Singapore into Hong Kong, but then Hong Kong into San Francisco was a 12-hour flight, and I was worried about that. But they had internet on the flight, and so I knew that I would be able to at least hopefully be able to stay connected. So before the flight took off, actually, I happened to see the flight crew standing there, the pilots and co-pilots, and I just walked up to them, and of course I'd been crying. Been crying since I'd left Singapore, and I said to the pilot, hey, are you the pilot of this plane? And he said, I am, you know, and he kind of turned to shake my hand, and he immediately said, hey, what's wrong? I said, listen, my son is in a bad condition at home, and I need to get home to him. and I need you to fly as fast as you can fly. And he said, we've got you, man. We'll take care of you. We'll do the best we can. And he said, on top of that, I'll make sure all of our flight attendants take care of you. And they did. They offered me whatever I needed throughout the flight. Of course, nobody else on the flight had any idea what was going on, so they just thought there was a crazy person on their flight that would randomly cry and weep. But I had a lot of, because I was able to be on the Wi-Fi, I connected with a lot of people and I text a lot of people, and people were Facebooking prayers, and it really helped sustain me. It really helped me to hold on during that flight. And the first half of the flight, so first 5.5 hours, I got a text. Actually, Barb had actually tried to call me, FaceTime audio me, and it wouldn't go through. I couldn't answer. And so eventually I tried to call, and I just texted her and said, I'm not going to be able to get through. And she let me know that it was getting close. And I'd been racing home. You know, my only goal at that point was to just see him before he passed. I just wanted to hold his hand and kiss him and tell him I loved him. And it was becoming evident I wasn't going to be able to do that. And so I was getting desperate, and I was sitting in my chair, and I was looking at a picture of him. I was crying, and then one of the flight attendants came up to me, and she said, I've heard about your son. And she goes, is everything okay? And I said, no. I said, it's getting close. And I said, I'm really trying to talk to him, but I can't get through in FaceTime audio. And she reached down and she grabbed me by the arm, and she picked me up and she pulled me up to business class first, and said, let's get you a better signal. See if we can find a better signal on this plane. If there's a better signal, we're gonna find it for you. And so she took me up there first, and I tried and I couldn't get through. And she took me up to first class, and I tried and I couldn't get through. And she said, well, what are you using? I said, FaceTime. She said, well, try Skype. And I thought, well, that's really kind of the same thing, but all right. But I thought, well, she doesn't have Skype, but she has Facebook audio. So I called Facebook audio, and my daughter, Amanda, answered. And I can't even tell you how happy I was. So I was able to talk with Barb, and there were so many people in the room. I couldn't see who all was there, but I knew Kinsey and Amanda and Darren and my brother, and a lot of close friends were there. And she kind of explained everything, and it was really hard, but I knew that, you know, Jackson was doing his best to keep fighting, and expected him to maybe last another couple of hours. And I told Barb that it was hard, but I was satisfied that I got to at least talk, and it made me feel better. And I talked to Jackson some and told him thank you for trying so hard. And I said, I'm going to try and hang up right now and call in over video. And if I can make it through on video, great. But if not, just know that I'm at peace with this call. And I don't know if you guys have flown and use Wi-Fi much on the plane, but when you look on an international flight where it says Wi-Fi, it says you might be able to get texts, and you're probably not going to be able to get audio, but you might. But you're sure as heck not going to be able to get video at all. It's an impossibility. But I connected on video with a crystal clear image, and I felt like God had really answered my prayers. And I saw everybody's face in there, and I saw Jackson. And it, to be honest, it hurt so bad to see him in that condition. His body his will was and his heart was fighting, but his body was letting him down, and you could tell. And it was hard to see him in that condition. So I had asked everybody to leave the room except the doctor and Barb and I. I just needed to ask a question about Jackson, and wanted to know if there was anything we could do to make his passing go sooner, because he didn't need to wait for him anymore. And the doctor just said, you know, if we disconnect all the life support, it would happen naturally. But, you know, over the course of the next couple of hours, and Barb held the phone to him, and I just told him, son, I'm so sorry I couldn't be there. I said, but I am here now, as best as I could be. I wish I could be there physically. But I'm with you now, and I'm telling you, son, it's okay to let go. You fought so hard for me, and I appreciate it because I know you've got to see everybody else you love dearly, and you were trying to hold on for your dad. And he took his last breath right then. And he died right then. And it was terrible. But at the same time, it was beautiful because I know that he heard me. I know in my heart that he heard me, and he let go. And it meant so much to me. And I was really worried then, though, that because Amanda and Kinsey weren't in the room. And so I had Bart get them back in there as soon as possible so they could love on him. And eventually, I told everybody how much I loved him, and I hung up and I went back to my seat. And this is the part that is kind of awesome for me, because I'm not a terribly religious guy, really. I tell people that all the time, and that kind of in that context is, I'm not really a religious guy, but I am a spiritual guy, and I am a Christian. I believe in God, and I believe in Jesus Christ. But I don't go to church on a regular basis. But I sat down in that chair and reflected about what had happened, about the ability for me to get the audio signal and then the video signal and the prayers that I had said. And the prayers that I said for Jackson and the fact that he was able to hear me and let go and be at peace. And this overwhelming sense of calm came over me. And I knew in my heart it was the Holy Spirit with me right there on that plane, helping me to get by for the rest of the flight. And I can't explain it other than I just know in my heart that's what it was. And I flew the rest of my flight, about another 6 hours, 5.5, 6 hours into San Francisco. And really, I was at peace. And I had a lot of smiles. I brought up a lot of pictures of Jackson the rest of the flight and thought of a lot of good things and knew I was going to be home with my family, and I knew it was going to be hard over the next couple days. But all I could think about was Barb and Amanda. And I knew that more than anything, we had to stick together as a family. And I knew that that would be enough, and I knew that we were going to be okay. So just the rest of the story, because it's important to me, is when I landed in San Francisco, the United crew, actually the people at San Francisco and United, rushed me through immigration and security, and I met up with my wonderful cousins, Donna and Steph, who flew into San Francisco to hold my hand and be with me to get me back to Boise. And it meant so much to me, because by that time, I know the Holy Spirit was probably with me, but but I needed my family too, and I was pretty upset and weak at that point. And it was so nice to have them there. And of course, when we got back to Boise, I was greeted by so many family and friends, and we hugged and loved and eventually came home and were able to laugh. And so I know that's a hard story for me to tell anyway. And I think it's probably hard to listen to for some, but I hope that in the end there's a message I hope that you guys get out of it, because it meant so much to me, as hard and as sad as it is, it meant so much to me to have those glimmers of hope and love from Christ.
I see now from all the people that Jackson touched that he is extraordinary. Jackson is loved by an incredible amount of people, and I know he was very blessed to have such wonderful people in his life. I will forever miss him, although I know he will always be a part of my life and forever in my heart. Jackson has given me a wonderful 2 years. I wish we could have had more time than that, but I feel extremely lucky to even have that time with such an exceptional soul. I will miss all those good times with him, even the simple times like driving in the car, cuddling during movies, and just simply being able to talk to him every day. I know that he is watching over me and his family, and I do believe I will see him again. I love Jackson so much, and I will never forget him. I know our love is something I will cherish for the rest of my life.
We love you forever and always, Jackson, but we know in our hearts that you live and that we will have many chances to feel your presence through memories and dreams. Until we see you again, son.